I guess you'll know that Spire is one of the three instruments on board the Herschel. Here you can see just brief layout and how the three instruments are positioned on the spacecraft. And the only thing that you need basically to remember is that this is Spire while this is PAX. So you see that they are on different sides of the focal plane, and I'll explain you later why this is somehow important. And this is a sketch of how Spire is done internally. So here you see the photometer, on the other side you will have the photometer, which Ivan will talk to you later. And here again you can see the focal plane of Herschel in the sky, and you can see this is the focal plane, this is the footprint of Spire on the sky, while this is where PAX is. And the important thing is that there is a separation of 21 arc minutes between the two, and this is relevant when you want to analyze or you do parallel mode observations, because obviously we need to cover at the same time with these two instruments some part of the sky. Another thing which is particular maybe for infrared astronomy, and maybe you're not used to, is that we use feed-on arrays. These are the three arrays of Spire, so this is going from 500 micron down to 250 micron. And you see that the number of bolometers, number of detectors is increasing. And the key feature of Spire is that the array is not filled, which means that basically if we just point the spacecraft in one position and we look with Spire, you will have a map which is filled with, it's basically an empty map. In the sense, you will have some pixels, but then all around these pixels, you will have other pixel, you will have holes. This is because this is not a CCD camera. That's the main point. The blue pixels, the blue detectors, are the call line detectors, which means that basically this detector over here is looking at the same radar position. It's call line with this pixel, it's call line again with this pixel here. The gray detectors are either noisy or dead detectors. Basically, these are not part in the pipeline, they are excluded from the pipeline. Since we don't have a field array, to cover a part of the sky or to fully cover a source, we need to somehow to scan. Typical way on which we scan, we have three modes plus the parallel mode. We have a mode dedicated to large map mode, in which we scan the array in given we fix an angle in respect to the spacecraft orientation, to the spacecraft coordinates. This angle is 42 degrees, 42.4. And so we first come in one direction, then to cover again, we do a step of 348 arc seconds, and then we scan backwards. And so the area over here is the common area, what we call the user requested area. So when you request an area, basically we scan first in one direction, then in the other one. In the typical Spire AUR, you can also ask for the so-called A and B direction. So let's say scan and cross-scan. The cross-scan you will basically scan at roughly 90 degrees. Actually, it's minus 42, so the angle between the two scanning directions will be 82.8 degrees. In a small map mode, this is just a large map mode with only one scan direction and the cross-scan. Over here, you cannot decide anything, so you just ask to point a given target and you decide the number of repetitions that you want to do this cross-scan. But the scan speed is fixed at this 30 seconds per second, and you cannot choose anything else. Well, for example, in large map mode, you can also decide if you want to do, if you want to use a lower or a larger speed, it's an advantage if you want to cover larger maps in a smaller time. And finally, we have this pointers mode, in which the main movement is done by an internal beam steering mirror. But we found that this is not really working efficiently. So basically, nobody is using this, and everybody who is interested in doing point source photometry is using the small map mode. So for the from now on, I will not even consider this map. Okay? So here again, this is a slide in which it's trying to explain you what SPIRE is doing while it's observing. So if you ask to observe this rectangle over here, what we will do with SPIRE with the spacecraft is to first scan in this direction, then we will move the spacecraft to this new line, then we will scan backwards, and so on. And then you can also ask for the cross scan, the same AOR, and you will do the same things like this. And so if you then look at the coverage map of the coverage map of the typical SPIRE observation, this is a coverage map at 250, this is a coverage map at 350, and this is a coverage map at 500. And the darker areas is where you have more accumulated points here, more hits. And over here, also another point is that when we are observing in the user requested area, we are always scanning it at a constant speed, which is the one that you lost. While when you are turning around the telescope, you will see later that you can add these turnarounds at your data. But over here, the speed of the spacecraft is not constant. But still, the data is good enough that usually you can add also these turnarounds if you want to get the larger area. In parallel mode, this is basically the same as a single SPIRE large map observation. The only difference is that, given the fact that PAX is a smaller array, we cannot use such a large scan step. And I remember it's 348 seconds. When we observe in parallel mode, this 348 is reduced down to 155 in one direction and 168 in the other direction. Another point is that you cannot ask for a cross-scan in the same AOR. So usually users also is asked or requested two different AORs, which means that from the data analysis point of view, you will have two different observations. So you will need to merge them to get the final map, which is cross-scanning. Well, then there are some smaller differences, like fast speed is always 60 seconds per second, but the medium scan speed is reduced from 30 to 20. And the other key point is that because we have to get both PAX and SPIRE data, we need to reduce the data rate of the two instruments. So in this sense, the SPIRE data rate, sample rate is lowered from the standard 18.6 Hz down to 10 Hz. While for PADS, the average frames on board, so basically data is degraded somehow in the two instruments. And the last point on parallel mode is that, as I mentioned earlier, there is a separation of 21 arc minutes between the two instruments. So if you ask, for example, to cover in parallel mode a region of 1 degree by 1 degree, you're actually observing something bigger, because you need to, the one by one degree will be the area observed by both instruments. So you will actually observing something like 1 degree plus 20 arc minutes. So this is taking more time to do it, but at the same time you will get slightly larger areas in both instruments. And you can see it here. So this is the area that the user usually asks. And the green one is the area covered by SPIRE, while the pink one is the area covered by PAX. So this is the introduction of the different modes that we have in SPIRE and parallel mode. And now I have a few slides in which I try to explain you what is the typical data structure in SPIRE, and now you can analyze and have a quick look at your data. I don't know if this morning they tried to explain you what is a product, what is a context, and so on. I don't want to go into too much details, because I think it's just confusing. But basically, so you will have something which is a product, which is just a container of all these other things, and which is the thing that you're basically interested in interested in the user is the data set, which is the data. But then you will also have some metadata and how the data has been processed. So the smallest bit, the smallest context, the smallest container that you have in SPI is what we call the building block. The building block can be contains other things, but which I'll explain you later, but the basic point is that a building block is created every time the instrument is doing something. So in a typical scan map observation, in a typical photometer observation, each building block is each scan line. So every time you move from point A to point B because you need to cover the area, this is a building block. Then when you start turning the spacecraft into the next scan line, this is another building block. Then you do the second scan line, this is the third building block, and so on. Then the building block, each of these building blocks is containing, will contain other stuff. The stuff that you are most interested in is the photometer detector timeline. You will have also housekeeping. So basically this means that we take the signals of our detectors and the signals coming from the housekeeping and we divide it into these building blocks. So this is the idea. You have a building block, which is a container of all these products. And again, you can take your observation, which we call usually an observation context. Inside your observation, you will have different levels of data and different products, different contexts, sorry. So you have a calibration, the auxiliary, and the different levels of data analysis. Now, we will go through this. So here is a sketch of a typical SPI observation. You have the auxiliary context, so you have the whole container, which is an observation context. Then you have inside, the first thing you will notice is an auxiliary context, which is containing stuff like the pointing product, the SIAM, which is basically an array which tells you where is the position of each detector in respect to the spacecraft and other things that basically you don't care. Then you have a calibration context, which is divided into photometer calibration context and spectrometer. But the most thing that you're interested in are these five levels. So you have a level zero, which is just the raw telemetry. Then you have a level 0.5, which is basically level zero ordered in time and with units converted into from some weird engineering values into volts. So something that you may understand. And usually this is the level from which you should start if you want to reprocess your data. Then we have a level one. I'm sorry, level 0.5 is divided into this building block which I was telling you earlier, where each building block is again some kind of instruction, some kind of movement that the instrument did. The level one is basically the level 0.5, so it's the detector timeline with all the instrumental effect removed and with units changed from volts to Jansky. While the level two is just level one regridded onto the sky with some mapping algorithm. And for some observation, we also have a level 2.5, which is the merging of multiple observations done automatically here. So it's basically when you get, for example, a parallel mode instead of having, I'll show you later because it's easier to understand. Then you have other stuff like the quality context in which you will have all the flags that has been raised during the analysis and if there is any comment that we produce over here because your observation had some issues, you will find this comment and the solution on how to reprocess your data and solve this issue, well, it's written in this quality context. And so all this structure is reflected in Hype. So when you load an observation into Hype, you will see in the outline box a nice thumbnail of the tricolor image of Spire, the OBS-ID number, the name of the observation, and this tree, which is basically reflecting what I just explained. So you have the auxiliary, this, well, these are just two products with the images, and then you have the calibration, the level 0, 0.5, 1 and 2. And for sound observation, you also have the 2.5. And, well, again, you can inspect this data in many ways. Typical way, so if you double-click on the observation, this will open the standard viewer, which is the context viewer, for example, or the observation viewer. And so you will show, it will show something like this. Over here you have all the metadata, so all the information of your observation. And here you have again the tree of the observation. So this is again the observation context, and these are the other, all the other contexts that you are describing. Another useful thing of Hype is that if you select your observation, if you highlight your observation variable into the variable view, then in the task view, you will have under applicable all the possible commands that you can run on this observation. Sorry, on this variable. So the content of this applicable will change depending on the kind of variable that you select over here. Okay, now more related to SPIRE. So as I said, the level 0.5 and level 1 data are very similar. They are both contexts containing the detector timelines. At level 0.5, this is data in volts with all the instrumental effects included. So you will see glitches, thermal drifts, etc. While ideally in level 1, all these effects are gone. Obviously, this is not always the case, but that's what we are aiming. And there is kind of direct link between the two. Well, apart these general things, so basically you can use the same product to show, to look at the two. So you can use the dataset viewer, the table or overplotter, or the power spectrum generator. The interesting thing is that for each building block at level 0.5 is containing what we call a PDT, which is a photometer detector timeline. And this is through the 0.5 to 1 pipeline. This is converted into a SPI photometer timeline. This is maybe more clear over here. So that's what I was telling you earlier. This is a typical 0.5 product context. So over here you see that you have 31 folders. Let's call it folders. And each folder corresponds some kind of action that the instrument did. So the first four folders are some kind of setup, basically engineering things that user don't have to care. The fifth one, it's a calibration building block. Again, you don't care about it. But the sixth one, so the number five, because we start at zero, this is the first science building block. So over here, this is the first scan on the area that you requested. Then the blue one is the turnaround of the spacecraft. So the spacecraft is turning from one direction, going backwards. Then it's followed by basically the following scan and so on. So you will always have an alternation of yellow ones, and the one is science, and the blue one, which is movement. When you go to level 1, basically what's going on is that you will just take the yellow ones. So all the others disappear, because you're just interested in science. So you cut out all the stuff which is not science. However, there is an option to include the movement. So when you go to level 1, you will see a very similar structure, but instead of 31 folders, you will have something like 10 folders. So 10 building blocks, which may or may not include the movement. This is up to the user. In the automatic pipeline, this is not included. So what I'm saying is that the standard pipeline just includes this scan and this movement and this movement. But in the interactive analysis, you can also leave in your level 1 the spacecraft movement to go from this scan to this. And so in this way, you will populate also this area, so you will get a slightly larger map, is it an advantage? And how can you inspect the data? So you can, it's very easy, you just go to one of these folders, you highlight one of the products. So if you, for example, if you open the folder number one, which corresponds to the second building block, you will see that there are these three products. The first two are housekeeping things, so let's say engineering things. The third one is PDT, which is, again, photometer detector timeline. But this is real data, this is science data. And you can open, for example, with the detector timeline viewer, which will show you something like this. Here you will have the three arrays. And if you click on whatever detector, it will show you in this window here the timeline of the detector that you selected. And so, for example, here you will see that there is a very strong breach that we hope it's going to be corrected while we go from level 0.5 to level 1. If you have a question, ask please. Well, again, this is another kind of viewer, so you can also, this is a level 1. So you can also show the data as an array, as a table, sorry, or you can choose to see it as a table, with the table plotter, so it will show you basic web as a in function of time, and then you can also overplot other bolometers, other detectors. And finally, in level 2 and level 2.5, you switch from timelines to maps. That's something more understandable, probably. And so obviously in Hype we have other tools to show maps and to do other nice things on the maps. And some of these I will show you on Friday. So now a brief description on the pipeline. What's going on in the pipeline specifically? So this is a rough idea. So we start from the telemetry of the spacecraft. Then over here at HSE, we run some kind of pre-processing, which basically creates the level zero data product. So when you download the observation from the archive or from whichever place, you will start from this level zero. Then we apply this engineering conversion, which basically it's only getting the level zero data, ordering it in time, and applying some calibration product, and convert it from engineering values to volts. And you get the level 0.5, which again is the usual level from which a user should start. Then we have some few things that I show you now to go from level 0.5, and then you get level 1. And then from level 1 again, you go to level 2 with applying a map making algorithm. So, what do we do going from level 0.5 to level 1? Well, it's rather complicated with all these nice things. The first thing that we do is to search for jumps in the thermistors. And later, I will show you an image on why we do that. Then the second thing that we do is to run first the glitcher, which is looking for glitches that take place in all detectors of an array. So we call it concurrent the glitcher. Once we remove all these glitches, or we flag all these glitches, we search for, we run another the glitcher. So you have two options actually in the pipeline, two the glitching options, which look for glitches taking place in single barometers. Then we apply a low-pass filter correction, which is applied because the barometer, the detectors on board the spy have some kind of time response. So basically, when you observe a target, the signal is registered on board at a different time. There is a delay between when you pass on the source and when the signal is registered, so you have to correct for this time response, for this delay. Then we convert from volts to jump scheme over here. Sorry, first, sorry. So we convert from volts to joules over here, and after that we use the thermistor information that eventually be collected over here. So we have two detectors on board which don't look at the sky; they just register the temperature of the array, and we use this information to correct for thermistor for temperature variations. And so this is done by this task over here, and then we apply other kind of correction, and finally we associate the position on which a given bolometer was observing at a given time, and what we get in the end is a level one, in which for every data point we already removed all possible instrumental effects, and you have a radar position, so we can reconstruct the final. Before producing the final map, we need to run a baseline removal. Why do we need to do that? Because when we apply this temperature fluctuation correction, we apply a calibration product. We need to use a calibration product, something which tells us what is the relation between the value of the thermistor and the temperature. The problem is that obviously this calibration product has an error at the level of 1%. But the 1% error in terms of Jansky means some tenths of Jansky error. So the main point is that we cannot go beyond this level, so the best thing we can do is just to compute a baseline from each timeline, and then we remove this offset. So basically, with this baseline removal, or the destriper if you want, we are removing an AC component. And finally, the final step after we remove this AC component, we run a map maker, which usually is just an A map maker, so we just regrid the data on the sky. Basically, this is the same that I just explained, but this is with all the commands that are in a Spire pipeline script. The other thing that I forgot to mention earlier is that the first thing that we do when we go to level 0.5 is that we attach to the science scan line the turnaround scan lines, sorry, the turnaround building blocks when the spacecraft is moving. This is done because when we run this filter correction, this electrical response correction, we need to extend a little bit our timelines. Otherwise, it's introducing some nasty effects. In the standard pipeline, so we first add these turnarounds, but then we remove it. And this is done over here. However, if you change this extend equal false to extend equal true, you will keep this data in the timeline, and then it will appear in your final map. So again, this is an option, one of the things that you can change when reducing your data. So one of the questions is, do I need to reprocess my data? Well, one of the good points is that usually Spire maps are good just out of the box. In most cases, you cannot do too much trying to reduce the map, the data yourself. There are some things that are, yes, that you may fix, and here I list four of them which are the most common. One is what we call the cooler part. The idea is that the spire detectors are cooled down at about 300 mK, but in the the cooler duration is about 48 hours. But in the first 7-8 hours, the cooler temperature is quite unstable. So this green line over here, if you can see it, this is the temperature of the cooler. The scale over here is less than 1 millikelvin. But you see over here it's really stable, while in this region here it's rising up. So basically the idea is that when we cool down spine in the first, at the beginning of an observational day, the temperature drops down, and then for the next 7 hours, it starts rising up, and then it becomes flat. So for some reasons that we still don't understand completely, the standard pipeline is not working in this region over here. So we correct for these temperature variations, but there is something left. That's the basic idea. So here we run, in this region over here, we run our temperature drift correction, and this is working nicely. And you see this map over here. But when the temperature is variating so much, our pipeline is not working. So these are exactly the same observations, exactly the same field. This has been taken, I think, 1 or 2 hours after we inspect to this one, while this took place during the cooler part. So over here you see that there are some drifts along the line of scan. And this is because, you will have the timeline over here, it's variating. So this is a typical timeline of a spiral observation. You divide this into building blocks. So let's think that each of these is a chunk, and then inside there you calculate, at least that's what the standard pipeline does. You compute the median, and then you subtract this median. The problem is, obviously, if something is rising, like here, you compute the median, something will go below zero, something will go above zero. And this is what happened here. So over here, you will have negative value. And since the temperature is not stable, along the scan, you will go from negative to positive. Then you turn the telescope, and again, you compute over here another median, so you will go again from negative to positive, and so on. But this is because you are using a median baseline. Obviously, you can try to get, for example, instead of dividing the observation into many chunks, you can get the whole observation and try to fit the whole observation with something which is not a median, which with a polynomial. Or you can use something which we call a describer, or many of you use Kanamorphos, which is the same idea, which works in a slightly more complicated way. And the way it's working, it will be explained on Friday. So another typical case, which is more or less been fixed in Hype 6 or 7, it's a thermistor jump. We know that from time to time we observe jumps into our detectors. It could be a single detector, which is not a huge issue because it's just one detector. But if a jump takes place in a thermistor, since we use this thermistor to correct all the other detectors, this is going to affect all the detectors in that array. So over here you have a jump. So the pipeline thinks that the temperature changed suddenly from here to here, and it will apply this correction, so it will propagate this error to the whole timeline. And you see over here, so this is a jump on the PLW T1. So the PSW map is okay, but the same map, because there is no jump, but the same map in PLW where a jump took place, the map looks okay until here. So here you have the thermistor jump. So the pipeline thinks that the temperature was higher, so what it does is to put everything lower. So the point is that you need to exclude this, the solution is that you need to exclude this thermistor from the pipeline. This is usually done automatically, again, from the current pipeline. But from time to time, it's not working. So it may, you still may see something like this. So if you basically see a night map and you see a darker or brighter region inside your map along the line of sky, along the scan direction, this is mostly due to the thermistor jump. So what you have to go, what you have to do is to go back to level 0.5, exclude the thermistor, so say, tell the pipeline don't use that thermistor, and rerun from level 0.5 to 1. Another typical case are glitches. So we have many the glitcher in our pipeline, but in order not to exclude too much data, and the, also they have to work on many different kind of data. It could be extragalactic or galactic at the same time. Not all the glitches are detected. So again, a good way is to try to play a little bit with the glitcher parameters, or you can also manually mask the glitches. Glitches are typically easily you can easily identify them, especially in the coverage map, in the error map, because you will see brighter pixels in the error map. And finally, another case which is not producing nice results with the standard pipeline are whenever you have bright sources or bright extended regions and so on, like in this map. So you will see that the final map will have a lot of stripes. Again, this is because we are just removing a simple median from each scan line. And if you have a very bright source in the center of the scan, basically this source is affecting the median. So you need either to mask this source, or you can use more complicated tools, again, like the distributor. The other thing that you may want to check is if you have the latest calibration tree. One thing is important to know, so the latest one is 8.1, and if you want to know what is the calibration tree associated to your observation, just run this command. One thing that is important to note is that basically from the Spiral tree version 4, the number of improvement, we didn't improve too much, let's put it this way, if you prefer. The calibration is already pretty good. It's a level of plus or minus 7% in the worst case. It's said to be conservative. And remember also that whatever it is in the archive at the moment is being reduced with at least hype 6.1. So the calibration tree is, again, spiralcals underscore 6.1. So this apply only if you download the data more than 1 year ago and you are still working on it. So either re-download it from the archive or update to the last calibration tree. And these are a few comments to get it. These are, well, in any case, this presentation is on the Twiki, so you will see these comments again, but these comments are also written in every user script that you find in the file. Talking of which, here now we introduce some user scripts. So if you go into Hype under Pipeline Spire, you will see four photometer user scripts for large map, parallel, small map, point source mode. At the moment, they are different. Sorry, they have different names, but they are basically, these three are basically the same. The large map and the small map user script are identical. The parallel mode one is a little bit different only on the glitcher part, because it's different the sampling rates. So a few parameters are slightly different, but apart two or three numbers, the idea is always the same. So the kind of steps that we run in our pipeline, it's always the same. So when you open one of these scripts, what do you have to change? You have over here a user input area, so you need just to enter your OBSID, the pool where the data is stored in case you have it on your local hard drive, And an output directory where the FITS files of the maps will be saved. Over here you have the spiral tree. I'll be back on this later. And at the end of the script over here, you will have the three lines in which saves the final maps as FITS files. So if you don't want to save them as FITS files, just comment that. So I was saying the cal tree, so this is the line in which basically you are loading your cal tree, your spy calibration tree from your local boot, so from your hard drive. If you don't have it, it will give you an error. So comment this line, and you can run this other line. Remember that when you run this line, if you don't have the cal tree on your hard drive, it will start downloading it from internet. It's something of the order of 600 to 700 megabytes. So it's taking quite some time to download it. At the end of this presentation, there are also other methods in which you can download download the cal tree from the Spire ICC webpage, not using Hive, at least for downloading. So you will not have to run Hive to get the file. And last thing is that once you load it, so this line, or either this line or this line, this will load the latest calibration tree into Hive. Then if you want to, the second line is updating the calibration tree of the observation with a new one. Once you save the observation, so let's say that you reduce the whole observation up to level 2, you are happy, then what you usually do is to save it back into your hard drive. Then it will be saved with the latest calibration tree. So again, the next time that you will load these observations, the re-reduced observations, you don't have to run either this line or this one, because you already have the latest calibration tree attached to your observation. I think in Hive 8, if I'm not wrong, we introduced a new menu, which is this little script menu, in which you will find some useful scripts. For the photometer, you have 4 scripts, which basically show some examples that you may use to start with. So the first one is astrometry correction, and it's showing you how you can use a new task that we introduced in Hive 8, which is an astrometry fix. So you give to this task a reference map or a reference observation, and it will correct, given this reference, it will correct the astrometry of the other observation. Then you have a baseline removal and the striker script, which show you some ways in which you can run different kind of baseline removals, so using a polynomial order, or either on the whole timeline or just on a single scan, or you can use the striker. Again, we will spend all the Friday morning on the striker, so this is something we will talk again. A map merging script, this show you how you can merge together two observations. You can modify it to merge together more than two observations. This is especially important when you have parallel mode observations, because as I said at the beginning, a user cannot ask to do scan and cross-scan in the same AOR, so you will have two different observations, and usually you want to have them merged together just to have your nice final map with cross-scan. Last script is a solar system object motion correction. I don't know if over here there is anybody interested in solar system objects. Pedro says no, so I can skip.
Any participant has a program on solar system objects.
I mean, the basic idea is that when we observe a solar system object, obviously a spacecraft is following the object, but the standard pipeline is not correcting for this. So what you will get is a nice map of the background, but you will not see the object. So with this script, this corrects for in the other way around. So you will have a nice map of the object, but the background will be blurred. So you cannot have the two things at the same time. Sorry. And last thing is Fire level 2.5. I think some of you may know these maps. And as I said, we have a new task which is able to find contiguous observations, so observations which touch each other, and at the same time they have to be observed in the same incompatible modes, which for spy photometer, they're all the modes are compatible basically. They have to belong to the same program, they have to be the same proprietary rights, and so on. The idea is that once you filter and when this task looked into the archive, it creates a list of observations, and then the pipeline merges all these observations into one, and it runs again the level 1 to level 2 pipeline. So basically, it merges together all the level 1s belonging to these observations, and it creates, then it removes the baseline removal, and then it creates a nice bigger map containing all these observations. Typical case is again parallel mode observation, or if you have different observations. So if some users, instead of doing one observation with 10 repetitions, they did 10 different observations with a slight offset. And here you can see a typical example. This is an M31 observation, observation M31. So this is a PLW map taken from the first observation. This is the four observations that we did to observe M31. So it's four because basically you have two fields and the cross cuts. And this is again with the standard pipeline. So you see that over here along the line of Andromeda, you still have dark areas because Andromeda is quite bright. When you remove the median, this affects the brightness of Andromeda affects the median removal. Then I run only on three of them, not four of them, the describer, plus I apply some other gain, some other corrections, which we will tell you on Friday. And you see that over here the dark arrow disappeared. Over here as well. So this is what you can gain using the describer, for example. Or scanamorphism. So what do we expect for Hive 9 and beyond? So we expect that the describer will become the standard tool for going from level 1 to level 2. At the moment is this median baseline, which is not always working, but it's fast, that's the advantage. We should introduce other way of doing a second level deglitching. There is also second level deglitching in the pipeline, but we are still testing it. There should be also a task which should correct automatically for this cooler bar, which I showed you earlier. And I don't know if for a Hive 9 or a Hive 10, we will plan to introduce a zero level correction taken from Planck maps. On Friday, I show you some ways on how you fit the flux of the source. And the recommended way is a timeline fitter. The problem is that so far the timeline fitter is just a Hive script. So you need to go on the Hive wiki page. Over there you have a timeline fitter and you can run it. And we plan to have a GUI task. There is something right now in Hive, but there's some bugs too. And the last thing is a bolometer finder, which is something useful, especially, for example, if you find glitches in your map and you want to exclude that glitch, then you have to go back to level 1, to the timeline, and mask the data. So the idea of the bolometer finder is that you will click on a pixel on your map, you will go back to the level 1 timeline, you can inspect it, because it will tell you basically which bolometer has seen that pixel, so which bolometer contribute to the flux in that pixel, so that you can easily find the bolometer which is causing the glitch and remove it. So basically that's all for pipeline. So for Friday, Friday, we will talk about the SPIA, the Spy Photography Interactive Analysis. This is not part of the standard hype distribution. This is a plugin. So these are three instructions that you should follow to install this plugin. You just start hype, then you open tools, plugins, and you click install new. A new pop-up window will show up, and over here you enter this address over here. You select install, and then you need to restart hype. Again, this presentation is on the wiki, so I just follow the instruction over here. Last slide is, I'm sorry, I didn't have time still to upload some demo scripts, which we will use on Friday. I will do it in the next days. And in this FTP repository, there are some observations of spy photometry that I will use in my demos. Obviously, you can also use your observations, so you just have to substitute the observer or whatever instead of the one that I will use. And if you need the latest calibration tree, again, this is the command that I showed you earlier, so this will run the download inside Hype. Instead, if you don't want to run the download inside Hype, you can just click on this link over here. It will download a jump file, and then in Hype you need to run these two commands. Just remember to change path to jump file, and so on.